Good afternoon, everybody. Bienvenidos, bienvenidos. Welcome to everybody here. We are so glad that you could come and join us in our 10th Lozano Long annual conference. It's hard to believe that this has gone on for 10 years and everyone seems better than the one before it. I'm Virginia Garrard. I'm the director of Lelos Benson, and we are extraordinarily pleased to have you here. It's my privilege to officially open our conference called Revoluciones Alimentarias, New Perspectives on the Contemporary Food System in Latin America. The theme of this conference is something of a departure for us in terms of this annual conference, but as ever, I feel like it represents what's at the very heart and the core of Lelos' mission and values. In the annual Lozano Long Conference, we work to build multidisciplinary academic spaces for discussion and also to create genuine diálogos saberes, otros saberes, dialogues of knowledge. We seek to bring together exchanges between different types of expertise, both within and outside of the academy. In the past, we have had public intellectuals, leading authorities, experts, actors, photographers, filmmakers, journalists, presidents, activists, rappers, representatives from foundations. We have covered a lot of ground, and I hope we'll cover quite a bit more. Our first Lozano Long Conference focused on the reemergence of the left in Latin America. This was 10 years ago, and we had former Chilean President Ricardo Lagos come to visit us and to discuss what the left was doing right. This was at the beginning of the pink tide, and things have changed since that time. Since then, we have reviewed the interpretations of Central American history by bringing together revolucionarios, leaders, and intellectuals who played significant roles during the Central American revolutionary period of the 1970s and 1980s. We reflected on global neoliberal policies that conditioned the refugee in part, conditioned and precipitated in part the refugee crisis in the Americas. We have analyzed the power of Latinos in the United States, the multi-layered effects of racism, particularly with the effect of racism on Afro-descendant people and indigenous peoples in the Americas. And we've discussed the environmental and social impact of natural disasters and the roots and pervasive consequences of widespread violence. Our Lelos faculty plays a leading role in identifying the key themes in the field of Latin American studies, and they help us to provide an analytical framework for the discussion that we enter into today, and they bring together renowned scholars and activists and people from the affected communities in these conferences. So with that in mind, I turn the baton over to the two organizers of this conference who have worked enormously hard in putting this together. And let me give you a little background on them first, and then I really will turn it over to you. Dr. Raj Patel is research professor in the Lyndon Baines Johnson School of Public Affairs at the University of Texas. And he's also a senior research associate at the Unit for the Humanities at Rhodes University in South Africa. He received a PhD in development sociology from Cornell University, and he's the author of Stuffed and Starved, The Hidden Battle for the World Food System, and the work, The Value of Nothing. Dr. Pilar Zazueta is Lelos' undergraduate faculty advisor. She has her PhD in history from Columbia University, and her research focuses on food, on how food and nutrition became a public policy issue in Mexico during the 20th century. Most recently, Dr. Zueta has been working on two grants with the Canadian Institute of Health. One of these has to do with implementing programs to improve women's health, particularly with pregnant women and early childhood development who are involved with substance abuse. And the other is to create a survey about gender violence and health in the Canadian sex industry. At Lelos, she teaches courses on research methods, the food system, gender, and contemporary Mexico. So without further ado, here they are.
This always happens, Jimmy, when I talk after you that I anyway, so hello, everybody. I'm Pilar Zazueta. So let me start talking about how we began thinking about this conference. This is an odd conference for a historian to organize because Usually we're concerned with the past, and this is very much about the present and the future. But that's the kind of thing that we do at Lilas Benson. We're very versatile. No? So this conference fits in perfectly with one of the guiding principles of our institute. We want to more effectively use, transform, and in some cases transcend traditional disciplines to better understand the complex problems of today's world. And one of those complex problems is food. Part of my interest in food is that my family comes from northwestern Mexico, from the state of Sinaloa, that is very famous for its export-oriented crops, both the legal and the illegal varieties. Well, mostly the illegal varieties, but that's for another conference. So one of the most vivid memories I have as a child is going to the tomato fields and the packing plants with my family members. It took me years to understand how the contradictions that I saw on the fields affected the livelihoods of many people, the workers in particular, but also the environment. Of course, I also came up with a very naive question. Why is it that in a country that has so much wonderful produce and vegetables, kids prefer to eat radioactive candy? And if you have ever been to Mexico and seen the candy, it is really radioactive, I have it. This has glycerin. If you put a match next to it, it combusts. And it's very spicy also. So radioactive candy has terrible side effects. And I should know, because I ate quite a lot myself, that I bought, of course, from the school cafeteria. No? But jokes aside, we do have a public health crisis in Mexico directly linked to diets. And of course, not only in Mexico. There was an article a few days ago in the New York Times about Vanuatu. No? That is a Pacific island I don't think it's under the jurisdiction of Australia, no? They have their own government. And in Vanuatu, it said, the article is that after trying every public health policy under the sun, they could really not control the diabetes and obesity epidemic that they were having. No? So now they decided to ban all junk food, no? And try to promote local agriculture. It will be very interesting, no, to see what happens there. No, unless Coca-Cola decides to invade the island, no, that it's possible, no, these days. I must say that, you know, jokes aside, that it's been a challenge, no, to maintain focus on fundamental issues, no, like food and the environment, especially in the last couple of months. But like the great South American philosopher Mafalda once said, the urgent and the, you know, that is quite alarming these days, never leaves any time for important issues. No? And we want to talk about in this conference about important issues. So for me, one of the main questions for food studies in general is how to reconcile conflicting values, practices, and institutions regarding the food system. And is there an alternative to market-based and agro-industrial thinking on food and food production? How can we have a healthier food system than the one that we have right now? Recently, we had a visit from David Kamowitz, who maybe a lot of you know, is the Director of Natural Resources and Climate Change of the Ford Foundation. So he paid us a visit at Lilas. But what he said I found very interesting. He talked about why indigenous rights in the Americas are key to fighting climate change. And he said something like, supporting indigenous efforts to protect their natural resources and their culture is plainly the right thing to do. But if that's not enough, many of us urban people who are increasingly disconnected from nature depend on indigenous people for the things we need to keep our planet healthy. David also talked about building bridges between those of us living in cities and what we have in common and the common interests we have with people we don't necessarily see every day. I firmly believe that talking about food is a crucial way of building those bridges. And in Latin America, those bridges are increasingly more important because we have a majority urban or peri-urban population. Also, I think we're on the right track because there is an emerging global food movement that is reimagining how we can grow and distribute food in a more sustainable and fair way. In Latin America, social movements made up of farmers, agricultural workers, consumers, environmental groups, indigenous communities, and experts have been pushing for greater food self-sufficiency, agro-ecological production, and equitable nutrition policies. Food studies, by nature, are multidisciplinary. This event will bring together people who have many different approaches to thinking about food and agriculture. The fields represented in the conference are anthropology, ecology, geography, public health, law, history, sociology, political science, and film. Topics include agroecology and alternative farming styles, rights-oriented food movements, the land, work, and market struggles surrounding industrial agriculture, and nutrition and public health approaches to food policies. Our panelists come from and are experts on different parts of the Americas, including Argentina, Bolivia, Brazil, Canada, Chile, Cuba, Costa Rica, Colombia, Mexico, Paraguay, and Peru. So I'm really looking forward to listening and meeting all of our wonderful panelists and participants. I'm sure I will learn a lot, many interesting things from them. So welcome to the 2017 Lozano Long Conference, Revoluciones Alimentarias. Thank you.
Thank you, Pilar. My name's Raj Patel, and I didn't realize that Pilar and I have a deep and abiding connection to candy like this. I grew up in a convenience store selling things like this and, you know, candy and potato chips and soda and cigarettes and pornography. It was, in many ways, an ideal childhood. We're not here to talk about it. My job right now is, first of all, to thank Ginny and the Lila Spence Latin American Studies Center and Collections, and to thank my wonderful co-organizer, Pilar, and also Paloma Diaz, the Aretha and Beyonce of Latin American Studies. You'll detect a musical theme here, and that's, you've seen some of the surprise that's coming up, but I want to keep this idea of music alive in introducing Humberto Rios. Because in order to understand the magic of Humberto's work and of agroecology, I need to make like Radiohead, and I need to just, you know, stare at my shoes and tell you how awful everything is. We need to understand how bad things are in the global food system today. I mean, we have an attitude to food production enforced on us by capitalism of take and trash. We take things from the environment and then we trash it. The best example of this is thinking about the oceans. By 2048, a time that many of us will live to see, the last commercial fish catch will be hauled from the oceans, after which nothing. By 2048. And then 2 years later, we will have crossed another threshold because there will be more plastic in the sea than fish by 2050. We take from the oceans and we trash it. And that dynamic, of course, plays out on the land as well. Humans' approach to food on land is little better. I mean, under industrial agriculture, we need between 1 and 10 calories of fossil fuel for every calorie of food that we eat. And that fossil fuel is going to contribute to climate change. By 2030, one study hazards that there will be 100 million people killed as a result of climate change as a result of the contributions of carbon emissions and greenhouse gases that agriculture is a major contributor to. And that will happen as we destroy the planet, exploit workers and their families, and trash the soil and peasant knowledge. And these are the good years. That does feel like a Radiohead song. You know, I mean, right now, we're only living with 1 billion people who are malnourished and nearly 2 billion who are overweight. And it's projected to get worse. But yet, we stick with it because we're told by the food industry and the chemical companies and the foundations and the governments that there's no other way to feed the world than through industrial fossil fuel-based agriculture, through genetically modified crops and monoculture and mega farms. Humberto is here to tell us how wrong that thinking is and how the knowledge of peasants working together with nature can and must be the basis of a new food system. How does Humberto know this? Well, he has a PhD He has a PhD in agricultural sciences from the Higher Pedagogical Institute for Technical and Professional Education in Cuba. But he's no ivory tower academic. Yes, he's published and written widely over dozens of countries in Latin America and around the world. Let me go back on that. There we are. And yes, he's won the Goldman Prize, the Nobel Prize of Environmentalism, that recognizes the work of those who live, and in the case of Isidro Baldanegro López and Berta Cáceres, those who die to change our relationship to the environment. This knowledge is dangerous because it threatens the established pillars of food, of capitalism. And yet, Humberto comes to know this stuff not by himself, but through cooperation, through co-production of knowledge with peasants and with the soil. And in addition to his phenomenal scholarly work, Humberto has published a novel and an album entitled Burumbun. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a demonstration that the soil isn't just the fount of food, but it's the fount of music, of life, and of joy. And it's for that reason that with great joy, I want to welcome to the stage the 2017 Lozano Long keynote speaker, Dr. Humberto Rios. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I don't know, what can I do? My previous presenter are doing better job than my own job. So it's a challenge now to overcome the barrier. So let me drink some water to relax a little bit. Yeah, so this presentation had behind a long history. Well, I prepared my presentation in Spanish. This morning I had to change to English. So it's the one issue. But anyway, I will try to do the best. First of all, I would like to say thank you to the organizers to bring me here and to share my experience with you. I'm really motivated because I noted that some Cubans are around here close to the music. There's one guy there. Yeah. From my neighborhood place in Cuba. So thank you to be here and to play for us later. Well, I don't know what you're expecting from me. This is a very good point. Oh, I will not talk about my experience, sorry. I will talk about the experience of Miko. And maybe some of you is asking, who is Miko? So Miko is one of the 11 million of Cuba living in Cuba, not in the States or in Europe. I know Miko. I'm living now in Spain. Just for clarification. How was educated this guy? This guy was conventionally educated. So, for example, you can see here a palm forest. And Miko learned how to convert the forest into the savanna to produce food, mainly milk and flesh. A meat, yeah, meat. What Miko learned in the university? This is a type of hierarchy of the knowledge. For example, Miko researcher are very intelligent, and all the money that the mother of Miko saved in life was to put Miko into the first level of the knowledge. But continuously, we can see the extension worker. They are a little bit less intelligent. And farmer, brutal. How many farmers are here? Just one, two, three. I'm sorry for the brutal. Consumer. In the model that Miko was educated, consumer was something that doesn't exist anymore. Local knowledge on that time, in the middle of the socialist revolution in Cuba, nothing to do with that. Local knowledge in that time was something like a folkloric issues or bewitches. But you know what happened in 1989? You know? The socialist country collapsed in Europe. Look at the table. If we look at the table, we can see in 1989 the amount of input that we import from the socialist country. In 1992, look at the figure and the percentage reduction. What is the cost of 1 liter of gasoline now in the States? More or less. High quality gasoline. 1 liter. $1. So you can imagine that in the next week, the price of the gasoline moved from $1 to $50. What happened? What will be the future? No long future, 1 week future. Cuba at that time was the most important agrochemical supplier all over Latin American countries. So what happened with what's cut off? Look at it. I can tell you if 1 week time, you will be living this situation. If the gasoline get 150 American dollar. This time, Miko's salary drops up to $3 a month. I took today free salary of Miko in breakfast and lunch. So Miko had to play in the bar to get tips, and because he was working for the Communist Party, was very committed with revolution, he was able to fund her own PhD. No Mannheim Foundation, no Rockefeller Foundation. It was the drunkard in the bar. They're just funding the PhD of Miko. In the middle of the crisis, personally, Fidel Castro said to Miko, you have a mission. You have to improve, you have to bridge the squash because we have so many problems here. The people is getting blind because the lack of vitamin A. So Miko has a revolutionary jump, say, okay, I will do. And Miko, as a scientist, went to the experimental station. When he arrived to the experimental station, the principal experimental station said, we have no fertilizer, Miko. We had no pesticide, we had no tractor, we had no oil, we are in crisis. Then, Miko, the professor, the lecturer, had to start to work with farmer. Working with farmer? The mother of Miko said, I spent all my money because I need that you stay in the top with the researcher in clean, very clean clothes, thinking how to feed the world. Yeah, I'm sorry, I have no option. My mother is melting down, mommy. And the mommy said, what a frustration. Chapter 3. The Mavericks. The dissidents. So it's Cuba, it's very dangerous to say that. Look at, in the middle of the crisis, Miko noted that some small farmers were facing the crisis differently, completely different. The big company of the state was suffering from the crisis, and all these small farmers were very happy, playing music, eating very good food, making love, doing everything. So Miko said, so the knowledge is not in the university. In the university, we are suffering from starvation. The knowledge is in this kind of people, in small farmer. Yesterday, when I arrived here, I make a quick call to Miko, and I asked him what kind of thing I have to share with the audience here. And Miko said, 4 points. The first one, diversity sits fair as an open source model. What is the meaning of that? Most of the public research centers have germ plants bank or seed banks that the scientists collect seeds all over the world, and they conserve in the refrigerator. Yeah? In the case that somebody, well, some disaster was going on, or for the professional breeder, something like that. But farmer never had access to that. So Miko take out all those seeds from the experimental station, from the scientists, and they planted in very big plots, and they invite hundreds and hundreds of farmers. So for the first time in the Cuban history, Miko said to farmer, choose whatever you want to bring to home, to make your own trials, and to test whatever you want to grow. Simple. What, do you know what was the reaction of the farmer? Yes, I need to see. Please, raise hand how many person here or who of you have been falling in love at least one time in life. In my case, one time, two times, three times, four times, a little bit dangerous, risky. Please, at least from the pet, from the dog. One time, very deep in falling in love. Two times. You are not very close to Latin American culture. No. So it was the same reaction. All those farmers who bring this amount of seeds to their own community, they invite like a falling in love person, yeah, to the neighborhood, community, neighbors, everything to see the new love that they capture in the diversity sphere. This is the second thing, the farm experimentation, farm trials. It was interesting to say, on that moment, that most of the experiments before the socialist country collapse were made in the research organization. And after that, most of this experiment was made outside, leading by farmer. No cost for the government. The third theme is the innovation festival. So innovation festival is a way that the farmer who are making trials in very small scale, they put on the table to the consumers. And something that Miko taught to me last night said, I realized that nobody is able to ask something that they don't know. So in the way that these farmers start to put all these new varieties and products that they were able to grow, the consumer start to say, oh, what a nice. And the fourth point is the crucial point. It's how to change the mindset, because he realized that the most of the intellectual people didn't know how to work with farmers. In theory, great, but in practice, most difficult. So he created, my friend Nico, the agro-biodiversity pollinators. It's like a bees, pollinating from this place to other place, merging people, merging ideas, making more prominent business managed by farmer. So agro-biodiversity pollinators spray dozen hundred crop varieties and promote farmer fields all over the island. Well, simple. For example, in year one, 30 agro-biodiversity pollinators were trained. Each of them bring on board 150 champion farmers. Plus 20 representatives of research and development organization and value exchange. Equal 170 catalyzer. Each catalyzer bring on board 8 new small farmers in year 2. So 1,360 champion farmers when bring on board, plus 30 agro-biodiversity pollinators, plus 60 representatives of research and development organization and value for change, equal to 1,450 catalyzers. Each catalyzer bring on board only 8 small farmers. In 2 years, this is the potential. I think it's less of the potential. The potential is more. It was the landscape. In 2000, 25 farmers started the project with Mico, 7 individuals from 3 organizations in Cuba. At the end of 2010, more than 50,000 farmers and 12 organizations participating in the process. Key findings. The learning group cohort. The cohorts. So the learning process was not developed in the classroom. The classroom was the scenarios that farmers were able to transform. So Mico involved researchers to learn in the physical and real scenarios of the change. Universities, farmers, policymakers, international organizations, and they tried to promote the change between them. And he realized that this kind of a change, the point that he was able to meet all these stakeholders, he called knowledge hot point, because the new themes emerged from the interaction. But the most important theme, when a diverse group start from the beginning, because it really hard to mix people, mainly intellectual people, because they want to all the time to keep the border. To keep the border, to keep the disciplines, and to talk about transdisciplinary issue, but just in theory, but in practice, that you have to work side by side with others to achieve to face a concrete challenge is a little bit difficult in practice. So, in the case that some crazy intellectual and crazy farmer decide to work together, was really amazing. From the beginning, they were able to identify a concrete challenge. And the knowledge hub point starts just from the beginning. The other important finding was the art. What have to do? What is the meaning of art in this speech? It's too much. You know Mendive? Mendive was one of the professors of Miko. Because Miko, when he started to see how the project started to grow quickly, he couldn't explain what was the cause of this growing. He knocked the door of the social science department, and the social scientist said, they started to explain about the social, the human, it's okay, but what about the biology of the process? They were not able to explain that. He moved to the next door to biologists, and he asked to the biologists, look at this reaction that I'm promoting now. How we can explain that? I start to talk about the biology, the multiplication of the plant, the cross-pollinated variety, but they don't consider the human beings in the process. But Mendive is a painter, he's an artist. This is the Cuban male, the Cuban black people, completely naked. And she is a lady from Cuba, completely naked. And this guy was able to paint the skin instead of to the wall. And his guy was able to bring artists, I mean musicians, to play African music. And they start to dance completely naked in front of thousands of persons, a big audience. And it was really incredible how the fusion of the painting, music, theater, you don't know where the border between the different disciplines of the art. So Mendive was the main teacher to teach Miko how to create transdisciplinary world. Multidisciplinary world. Nico noted that performance is a boundary product. And the collective action of different disciplines to get a performance. And this is innovation. The other important discovery that Miko had well, the farmer that was working, were working with Miko, most of them have diversity of product for self-consumption and sell, channel of commercialization, alternative to keep relation with clients, these champions of farmer champions. They were able to make some investment. They were able to make the social network not only for social issue, but also for business. And the big surprise of Miko living in the communist country was behind every champion farmer, Miko discovered one or more business models. Sadly, Miko was fired. Too much success in a few years. However, Miko was invited to Bolivia. Bolivia is a natural resources rich region. Yeah, a lot of natural resources. A really rich country. And Miko invited me to join him. When we arrived, I and Nico, to Bolivia, we realized that the nation received a lot of incentives from international cooperation, from American, European, SDCs, Switzerland Development Corporation, all kinds of cooperation. And when we arrived there, the farmer asked me for money. He said, come on. I have no money, I'm not a gringo. I'm just arriving from Cuba. Are you crazy? I'm looking for an opportunity like you. Shall we work together? And Miko encouraged me to sing to them. Dicen que el negocio incita nuestras más bajas pasiones, pero he visto corazones destruyéndose en el ocio mucho más que en el negocio, compay, de todas las poblaciones. Lo que jode es el ocio, no el negocio. And the farmer said, come on, crazy man. You are a technician. Technicians do not do business with farmers. We said, shall we meet your group or community? Yes. We arrived to the community and they said, we are supported by technicians to carry out field school, great, to grow maize and peanut through zero tillage. Excellent. And they say, even though we received some project inputs to buy seed, herbicide, fertilizer, herbicide is not so good, to grow maize and peanuts, we are losing money. Maize and peanut price are very low in the market. So we realized in practice that farmer field schools were a business for technicians, not for the farmer. So international corporation pay to the technician to teach the farmer, but the farmer don't get any kind back. So, how to create a business for the owner of the problem? So we developed some learning cycle with ICRA, Miko, myself, and ICRA. In order to strengthen the capacity to catalyze rural business in Bolivia, it was to change from the subsidy model to more business model oriented. So we did a lot of work. First, we organizing different workshop. Mainly the scheme was the 3-day workshops, and afterward they make an action plan, and during 3 months they go to the field and to validate the challenge that they identify in the residential module. And after that, he returned back to the workshops. The main question that we also emphasize what are the real challenges after this team worked with local stakeholders. Because one thing when we are here thinking about the food system, and another when you get down and to start to look for and to work with diversity of stakeholders, it's completely different. So we forced them to do this kind of exercises. And they correct the action plan for 2-3 days, and afterward go to the swimming pool again, to the field work. So, and they exploring what the champions, what the farmer, they really want to be different, and they want to make business with the natural resources that they are able to manage. So the third module was the same. So they validate they're prioritizing business opportunity with small farmer, the technicians. And at the end, in the fourth module, three-day workshop, was a big discussion. They invite a lot of people to discuss the findings, etc. So it was a chaotic process, because it was 3-4 steps forward and 5 steps backward, sometimes 5 forward and 3 backward. It's like life, like a real life. But it was really to change the starting point that people thinking, asking money all the time, to seeing that the money is not the most important point, it's the effect that you are managing something well done and with so many value. They have not conscious about the value that they have in hands. Why I have to give money to you? No, it's not fair. What were the limitation, or where were the limitation of this action learning program? The first, the project coordination who contact us, Mekong and me, they don't like the chaotic process. They could not control the process. If you don't control the process, I'm so happy. I achieved the goal. It's so incredible how people, even people that can be able to sit here with us, when you put the power in your in its noise, start to see, I am a mouse, and buy the cheese. Say, no, you told me that you want to empower people. Empower people means that you cannot control them. The socialist government organization were skeptical because, you know, the world of business, and Miko and me came from the socialist country, I know that, but everybody made business. Otherwise, they cannot survive. But you know, it was an interesting process at that time in Bolivia. And the other thing, the format six sector only recognized improved seed by professional breeder. It's really unbelievable in such country with such diversity, in theory, they are defending the Pachamama, but in practice, they don't recognize the variety created by farmer, which are thousands and thousands and thousands. But the participants were so, so happy. Mainly farmer female organization. Ah, women like business. Really? I can tell you because of my wife. They manage me all the time. All my business, all everything. So at the end of the day, the team business model was created. And the break even in less than 1 year is unbelievable. And the sad things, or the good thing to say, they were applying for more than 3 years to the government for money. It's a, how you say in English, it's a vicious circle. And the government get a lot of improved seed, a lot of fertilizer, and you have to follow my rules. If you follow my rules, I can think I'm going to provide as a gift agricultural incomes, inputs. They were asking 4 years, no reaction. In less than 1 year, he started to see how this thing is moving on. So it's very important, very, very important that the owner of the problem should become the owner of the solution. It's the main message that I want to give to you. Mainly, the innovation systems are being created to people like us, very intelligent, PhD, will solve the problem of the poor. No. You will spend a lot of money and the result will be very bad. At least in my own experience, and of course, the Miko's experience. Lesson that we learn. So most of us, we are immersed in these centralized innovation systems. And we really love to be more horizontal. Yeah, ah, nice, lovely, you know? The challenge is how. Yeah, look, if was the project that make us start in Cuba, it's a long process to change paradigm. Really long process. In 1990, Miko, my close friend, was considered like a crazy, because he want to involve farmers in plant breeding that is mainly focused on scientists, not in farmers. Was, you are crazy. So he started to identify some farmers. It was the incubation, the entry point. Catalyzer started participatory seed improvement. After that, the process jumped not only to plant breeding, but also to other disciplines. And you know, after 20 years, the society, I mean the governments, start to recognize like an like important process for cure. However, I can tell you, from this experience, action learning can be an accelerator. Because we cannot spend more than 25 years in this process. It's too long. The other lesson that I learned from Miko is innovation agriculture is not only for scientists. Institutions and organizations who break the linkage with informal knowledge got sick very, very soon. Illiterate person can be great. Please remember me, my grandmother. He was not able to read and write, but he was prominent making business. Letter, no. Numbers, woof. Terrible. The other important points to change the paradigm is to look for, to identify something simple. The complexity theory have not a space on that. Something simple that the people can't replicate themselves. For instance, this is a plot with different diversity of seeds. Very simple, planting different rows. And this diversity are released to different farmer, and different farmer to release to other, something simple. And at the end of the day, they start to organize according to the innovation, not for the credits or for the subsidy of the government. If you want to apply for money, you have to be organized, and the people invent an organization. The other very important themes is you don't know how food system is working until you start to change it. This is the big difference between information and knowledge. Information is when you receive information, and knowledge when this information is put into practice and you have to change. This last thing is knowledge. Normally, paradigm change is associated with crisis. So we have to create crisis promoter. it's a craziness. I think it's very, 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 very important, and that is why I'm here. I accept your invitation, because promotion in the official educational organization curriculum toward more dynamic education is a key point to change paradigms. You are working with young generations, with different set, with different mindset. Finally, honestly, I would like to say to you, when plant breeders like me are leading plant breeder business, bureaucracy increase and business opportunities are far away. However, when farmers and other champions of the seed value change are leading breeding business, crop diversity increase and business opportunity come through. Come through, for sure, absolutely. I have no doubt about that.
I have time to think.
Yes or no?
Yes.